Hey, I'm Jared Potter, and today we're going to be talking about designing for Windows Phone 101. I am a UX designer and developer, and for the last 3 years, I was one of the design integration leads in the mobile studio at Microsoft, designing Windows Phone and a couple other projects. For the last couple of months, I've been the principal designer at 6th Ave Studios, and you can always reach me on Twitter at Jared T. Potter or LinkedIn at Jared T. Potter. This presentation is a series, it's part of a series of design that's talking about Windows Phone 8. First, we're going to be talking about the high-level question of what is design. Next, we'll be discussing the Windows design language, next, design-driven product, Windows Phone 8 features, and then lastly, we'll be talking about the whole-up Windows ecosystem that Windows Phone 8 is a part of. The first thing that we'll talk about today is what is design. There are many definitions for design. A lot of different people think about it in different ways. In a lot of ways, the difference between art and design is a question of intent and intended audience. But really, one of the things that I regularly heard coming in the design studio is mobile design necessary? And is this app that I'm working on, is it necessary for me to spend the time and the resources on design? And sometimes that came from people who were just working on simple things, like a productivity application or a scheduling application that didn't seem like something that would really have a huge impact if they added a lot of time and resources and budget to the user experience. And I love this quote that comes from Douglas Martin in a book about design. A practical introduction. It says, questions about whether design is necessary or affordable are quite beside the point. Design is inevitable. The alternative to good design is bad design, not no design at all. Another quote that I love is from the documentary Helvetica, and this is from the famous author or designer Massimo Vignelli, who designed a couple things like the American Airlines logo as well as the New York City subway map. And he says this in his broken English, life of the designer is a life of fight. Fight against the ugliness. Just like a doctor fights against disease, for us, visual disease is what we have around and what we try as a designer to cure with design. One of the things, stories that calls to mind when you're talking about design is the gardens at Versailles. And I remember hearing this story from a good friend of mine, a designer, named Robbie Ingebretson, who went out there, and a couple of years ago, I had the chance to go out there with a few friends, and he showed this picture to another friend who said, what do you think about this? Isn't this beautiful? And their reaction right off the bat was, yeah, it's so cool and simple. And if you've ever been out to the gardens at Versailles, you'll know one thing right off the bat, it's not simple. It covers over 2,000 acres, and there's different types of plants and gardens spread out all over the place. The main thing that makes this feel simple, and when you first look at this design, is that it's given order. Every single different object has been placed in a specific location, and that order comes across to the human eye as simplicity. This is the job for many, many different designers in many different roles. For a stylist or a fashion designer, it may be taking all kinds of different materials and putting them in such an order that you see the design and it feels simple and it feels beautiful. For an architect, it may be like using a location or using all kinds of building materials. For the graphic designer, it may be something like a menu or supplemental facts about, you know, ingredients. For us, on a Windows Phone design, it was more than just putting a calendar and a map and a clock and books together on a device. When you're working on a mobile app, you're thinking about a lot of different things. You're thinking about business requirements, research, schedule, the design language, market analysis, and of course, technical limitations of the devices that you'll be working on. If you can take all of those and put them in an order that feels simple, it goes like this quote, design is the conscious effort to impose meaningful order. And that's a beautiful quote by Victor Papanek, but what it really means is that when you put that device in your hand for the very first time, it feels simple, it feels beautiful, and it feels easy to use. Alex White once said this, to design means to plan. The process of design is used to bring order from chaos and randomness. A couple of things that I like to go back to when I'm trying to bring order to a lot of different requirements is use order to create the appearance of simplicity. This can be used in many different ways, but one of the easiest ways to approach this is just manage the relationships, not the elements. When you're laying out a page for the very first time, it's really easy to just take everything and lay it out in a visually beautiful way. In a lot of ways, that's graphic design and not interface design. In interface design, you need to think about the tabs that correlate to the content so that they'll realize where they're at in the hierarchical navigation structure. If anything, it feels out of order, it may not belong. So do not be afraid to remove disconnected content. In the design studio, when we were moving from Windows Mobile 6 to Windows Phone 7, a lot of the project managers took on the role and the title of Fierce Reducer of Elements. We had all these great features, but they weren't necessarily a great goal for the end feature. And so what we ended up doing is saying, is this necessary? Is that necessary? And pulling elements out until we got to the absolute final beautiful design that we needed to work with. In a lot of ways, we see that design is order. The next point I'd like to make is that design is problem solving. At Microsoft, we had a team basically dedicated to doing user research. And one of my favorite stories in the design studio was when she was testing an old product, it actually made one of the user participants cry when they'd held it. And I won't say which product it is, but you can see the frustration that people get when they start working on these. A lot of these frustrations and little dead ends that come from working on an application can be removed by just using common sense. So common sense says that whenever I talk to someone or I have a history of talking to someone, I should be able to look up on my phone what they said in an email or a text or a voicemail or all of these different things. A lot of devices don't allow you to see all of those in one area. So we started thinking about it, and on a contact card on Windows Phone, we put those all in one location so that you can look at it and see everything, whether it came from text or Facebook or an SMS. This seemed like an easy feature to pull off. It was actually quite difficult, but it just made sense. So we put the time and effort into creating it. Another example of that is the browser search bar. In Internet Explorer, on the very first version of Windows Phone, we kind of got it wrong. We put it up at the top of the browser, and after some user research study, we found that it was difficult to hit, and it wasn't consistent with the rest of the product, where the application bar was nested at the bottom of the UI. We moved it down to the bottom with a little bit of common sense talking about it, and it ended up working out great. So a couple of my points about problem solving is, think outside the box and use a little bit of common sense. It's a weird thing to say in a presentation to use common sense, but when you're thinking about all kinds of requirements like hardware, budgets, and timeline, sometimes the last thing on your mind is actually the common sense that a user would use when they're trying to approach your product. The last thing I'd like to say is design is empathy. In the design studio, we have a studio playbook that said, the end user is king. The point of this was to say that whoever is going to end up holding the phone in their hand is the most important person in the design process. It's the person we think about all the time. It said this, the consumer decides, we're helping to elevate Microsoft product experiences to be more relevant, to be more emotionally connected, and to be there for our customers' needs with real solutions. We need to listen and empathize with real customers, become the advocate. We will prioritize our work to make sure that we deliver the best possible experience to our customer. This quote comes from Debbie Millman in a book that she says, How to Think Like a Great Graphic Designer. In the book, she interviews a ton of different famous graphic designers who have done amazing designs, and she says this about all of them. Many of the designers in this book describe design as a problem-solving activity, yet it's clear that these designers do far more than that. Despite the obvious similarities, there's one trait shared by each and every person in this group of designers, high levels of empathy. So one of the things that I would encourage any designer to do as they approach an application for the first time is flex your empathy muscle. Think about the end user first and get to know your user. In the design studio, we did this many different ways. We used personas, and personas are basically a made-up person that exemplifies a large target base. And you give that person a name and measure every single design against this person. Would Alex actually appreciate this? Would Alex actually use this? It seems like a great feature, but is it something that Alex actually needs? Another thing that we did in the design studio is a lot of user research study. We get real users in front of UI that we've designed. This is something that I would recommend for everyone. Get scrappy about it. Get your designs in front of a user by any way means possible. One of the ways that we would do it really quick and dirty is quick draw out a UI, take a picture of it on a phone, put it in the Photos app, and then have someone click on it and say, can you go to the settings screen? And if they click the wrong place, you probably put it in the wrong place and you need to revisit your design. This is something that I would definitely recommend to any designers. You think that you have all the right answers as a designer, and I know this for a fact, but for myself, speaking for myself. But until you get a design into someone in somebody else's hands, sometimes all your preconceived notions are a little bit off. That wraps up what is design for Windows Phone 8.